panel members tonight, Phil Bronstein, editor-at-large and vice president of the San Francisco Chronicle and editor-at-large of Hearst Newspapers. Cara Andrade, online community organizer of Spot Us. Cynthia Typaldos, the founder and president of Kachingle. And Lowell Bergman, a professor at the Berkeley School of Journalism and producer and director of PBS Documentaries. Thanks for being with us. Panel, let's get right to it. Do we accept the premise of this panel, the death of newspapers? So let me ask you first, maybe we'll start with Phil and work our way down. Are newspapers really dead? And if they are, should we miss them if they've outlived their usefulness and we can get the news somewhere else? Should we even care if they go away?
Well, since I'm the one who's dead here, apparently. But I see my doctor in the audience, and maybe he could come up and actually determine if that's true. The problem is that there have been so many discussions about, with the premise being newspapers are dead, that it's in our nature as journalists to want to challenge assumptions. And so I always kind of want to say, well, no, they're not dead, just because everybody else is saying they are. I think the old model of newspapers is dead. That model is 80% advertising revenue, 20% circulation revenue. That has been the standard for a long, long time, and that is dead. And you'll see newspapers, those of you who get, how many here get newspapers still? Okay, so this is a pretty big.
Most of the people.
Most people in this, for those on the radio, just about everyone raised their hands. I'm sure a few of you have noticed that the price has gone up recently. Not just for the Chronicle, but for the New York Times and every other newspaper. So that's what they call a pricing strategy. And the pricing strategy is, we have undercharged for this product that cost us all this money to put out for so long, and we were making really good money from that thanks to advertising. We no longer are, and so we need to change that equation. So that's what's happening. So newsrooms are being cut down, newspaper staffs, non-newsroom staffs are being cut. Outsourced printing, which the Chronicle's about to go to in a few weeks. Various things are happening to seriously cut the so-called cost structure. And I think the argument is, well, do you also not cut the quality when you cut the staff? I think when talented people go out the door, there's no question that you lose something. But the question I ask people when they ask me, gee, what can we do about saving the newspaper, is how much you want to pay for it? Are we going to pay $5? A newspaper? Gentleman here is shaking his head, no, he's not. Are you willing to pay $3? I mean, you know, these are questions that we'll be asking ourselves for probably some years to come. I think there will be print products for quite a while. I also think that there will be a shift at some point. Some subset of people who currently read newspapers will shift to these readers, the Microsoft Reader, the Kindle. There's something, first paper that Hearst is developing. And I think that the cost of that, if we could make that shift tomorrow, you would see newspaper newsrooms. Because let's remember, newsrooms run by newspapers are still the only institutions, newspapers are the only institutions that support large groups of journalists in one place, still. I think Politico has, what, maybe 40 journalists, and that's the second biggest. The LA Times still has about 600 or 700. So I think that to support those journalists, if people were to shift tomorrow to one of these readers and you could get rid of all those other costs, the presses, the printing, the paper, the delivery, that newspapers would have a significantly longer life. But how fast can we make that transition, I think, will determine how long newspapers stick around. There's no question it's going the wrong direction at the moment.
Cara, maybe you could explain for people what Spot Us is, how it works very briefly, and then should we care if newspapers go away as they exist now?
Sure. Spot Us is a community-funded journalism project, and it's something that started in November of last year, and we were funded by Knight News Challenge grants. And so far, since we launched in November, we've been able to fund, at this point, we're pushing 30 stories at various different capacities of investigative journalism and some video stories and radio stories. I mean, it would mean a lot to me if newspapers stayed alive, you know what I mean? Because I actually like reading the New York Times as well, and mm-hmm. the Chronicle I still subscribe to, although I don't often see it, because it gets stolen by my neighbors.
That's a good thing.
It's awful. I think what ends up happening is that we confuse the packaging with the content. It's kind of like saying, you know, is styrofoam dead? I mean, to some extent, we still use styrofoam, but like what we really want is the meat that comes in the styrofoam or the veggie burger for me, right? Like I still want like what's the content inside of it. So like I feel that for a lot of people, especially like in my cohort, in my age group, what the journalism still matters. It's the distribution that's not working for a lot of people because, you know, by the time you get your paper in the morning, I mean, like, I think about, like, what happened in Honduras, like, what's happening with, you know, with the president being, you know, basically, like, pushed out of his own country. Like, that's still not going to make it. I mean, I didn't make it to the paper so like, 24 hours later, barely. And then by that point, we've already got, like, at least, like, 1,000 tweets going out. You got people, like, posting a lot of videos. And so it's kind of irrelevant to a certain extent for creating a conversation. So I think that I think we need to really focus on making journalism relevant to different audiences and making it as accessible as possible and offering many points of distribution to as many people as possible. And I'm not just talking about like English speakers in the States, I'm talking about multilingualism and I'm talking about international journalism as well, where they still read newspapers. Like I'm from Guatemala and people still come down from the mountains, you know, an hour and a half, they scale down the mountain to like pick up their paper. Because it's what it means to them is being connected to a community and to a larger conversation.
Cynthia Typaldos, tell us a little bit about Kachingle, how that works, and what your take on this is.
Well, sure. Actually, I want to start talking about news, and I do believe newspapers are dead, but the news is not dead. In fact, news sites like the New York Times have an enormous readership. The New York Times has 19 million unique visitors a month. The Sun in the UK has 27 million unique visitors a month. I think the Cron, SF Gate and the Cron have about 5 million. I'm not sure that exact number. So people are reading the news in, you know, traditional news from traditional news organizations and loving it. And the problem is all about monetization. So I'm not going to really talk about the past and the paper and all that because the two speakers before me have. But what we're looking at with Kachingle is a way to allow news organizations, whether they be the Huffington Post or the New York Times, SF Chronicle, cable TV, whatever, you know, whether it's news or any kind of content, to be able to tap into their readers' desire to support the site and to get recognition for doing so and to build a persona. So Kachingle allows readers to sign up for a subscription fee, which initially is $5 a month, and then as you visit the sites that you love, you turn on what we call the medallion. And every month, then we take your $5 and we distribute it across the sites that you said you wanted to support. And at the same time, we're tweeting what you're doing, and we're creating a personality for you that really is all about you, which is really what everyone's interested in, which is themselves. And we believe part of the power of this is going to be that people's personas are moving online, and it's really going to be who I am. And you see this now on Facebook, where I think just today they announced that they're going to be opening up all the feeds to the public unless you know, make it private. So we're all about the future. We're all about monetization of great content, whether it be journalism content or video content, audio content. That's our plan.
Lowell, Bergman, you know, we've had this conversation probably various members of this panel on and off for 20, 30 years, maybe more. Are newspapers dying? Are they dead? What's the future? Should we care if the piece of paper that is dropped on my doorstep goes away and I have to go online to get it? Does it make a difference?
Well, first of all, when we talk about newspapers, there is newspapers and there's newspapers. And there's journalism and there's news. So when we talk about the New York Times, we're not really talking about most other newspapers in the United States historically. Most of them, when they did do any real news reporting, did it despite the fact that most of the ways they made money was from advertising and they were a monopoly. And it reminds me that in all these discussions that once upon a time there were monopolistic news organizations, advertisers were stuck with them, they made oodles of money. Then the technology that was available made them expensive to produce. They didn't do very good reporting. They didn't, for instance, tell us that the government was lying to us about a war that was going on or that we were in the process of pursuing. They didn't tell us about torture. They didn't tell us about spying on our own people. They didn't tell us about the environment being destroyed or that they were using bribery to get business. Then along came a new technology. They could reach a vast audience for free. It was entertaining, effortless. It was called at the time the Vast Wasteland. People went to it. The result was half the news organizations in the United States, particularly newspapers, went out of business. The new technology led to this, to new news organizations, new opportunities, and a new kind of reporting that revealed the spying, the lying, the torture, and everything else, and the years with 1968 and 69. And so what we had is a birth of a new kind of journalism based out of a new technology. One was broadcasting, but the other was actually offset printing coming into the world, where it allowed more people to have access to doing news. I was one of those people. It was called the alternative press, and I guess we were citizen journalists at the time, without editors, traditional editors, and without a lot of the constraints. Much of the investigative reporting that we now say is so valuable spawned during this period of time and was generally done by freelancers. It wasn't done by the major newspapers in the United States. So what we're in now is the end of a 40-year cycle where we're seeing a new technology, new models. Some of the new models are nonprofit organizations that are now doing investigative reporting. There was recently a meeting back east which was to create an investigative news network of nonprofits. Major news organizations that actually do quality reporting, like the New York Times, the newspaper itself, which I've worked for off and on over the last 10 years, makes money, as does its website. And you do have to make money or be prepared to lose money in order to do real reporting, which is the only reason why most of us are up here and talking about it. We're not talking about the demise of the newspaper because we're going to lose comics or because we're going to have various kinds of astrology or entertainment that's in the newspaper or even the ads that are in newspapers. We're talking about the demise of newspapers and, by the way, traditional broadcasting news, because it may end the national common consciousness that we've learned to share over the last 40 years, where you're actually exposed to information that you wouldn't normally choose yourself. And that's one of the great weaknesses of the internet and various search engines, where you put in your preferences. That means you won't necessarily learn about stories that are extremely important in the public interest if you chose yourself. And so that's the real content issue, and that's the real reason most people are upset. There are lots of newspapers that are disappearing because they weren't very good to begin with, and they never got very good. Occasionally they would do a valuable news story or break some news, but generally speaking, they were all stenography. And so what I think we have ahead of us is actually a brighter future with new alternatives, with new access to distribution that we've never had before. We're just going to have a dangerous period of transition between where we are now and where we'll be in 5 or 10 years.
You raise all sorts of additional points and questions. Panelists, if you want to jump in at any point, go right ahead. I think Phil had something he wanted to add. But let me ask you this. Did the television broadcast journalism of 40 years ago, did it live up to its promise? Is it a survival of the fittest thing? And now we'll see that with the internet.
Well, 40 years ago, television was forced through regulation to do news. It wasn't there was once 15 minutes in nightly news and it went to 30, but mm-hmm. at ABC News that didn't happen until the early 70s. Generally speaking, they only did documentaries on television when they got caught bribing people, like in the quiz show scandal, because they were mm-hmm. afraid of regulation. They found out in the early 1970s that doing quality news actually drove an audience to the network and made money. And then 60 Minutes, it's both advantage and curse, was that it made lots of money. And it was in the top 10. And in the years I spent there, the 14 years I spent there, they never could figure out why they were making so much money or why so many people were watching it. But one of the reasons they concluded is true, and it's still true today. 60 Minutes is on at 7 o'clock on Sundays, which is a federally protected time period. You have to run public interest broadcasting opposite it. So nobody's come up with a competition that can really take their audience away. And that exists today. So the whole idea of, for instance, deregulation and so on, I think needs, just like there are bailouts going on now mm-hmm. of the banking industry and discussions of how to regulate that industry, I think you're going to soon see the same thing in the news business. Remember, we're the country that, when we conquered Japan and Germany, instituted public broadcasting in both countries, funded by the government. The British have the BBC. The Guardian newspaper, which has a huge website, for instance, is a nonprofit. So the idea of the kind of news and information that I think we're all concerned about and why we're gathered here is that kind of information, information that doesn't by itself necessarily have a profit-making market, but that's in the public interest.
A lot of these companies, media companies, have gotten too big for their own good. You mentioned the New York Times makes money as a newspaper, but the company is losing money and selling off assets. Kachingle and Spot Us, you hope you have this problem someday, I would imagine, that you get too big and
yeah, we have no assets.
Worry about your size.
We got great postcards.
What's to keep this from happening to the new providers that in 25 years we're here talking about breaking up big internet companies and what's going to replace them?
I mean, I think what's happening with Cynthia's project and with Spot Us is, you know, you have this emergence of a lot of nonprofits and a lot of experimental approaches to doing public media and community-funded media. And I think, to me, that's more of that needs to happen in order to, you know, really create models that are going to be relevant to different audiences. I mean, with Spot Us, like, everybody seems to be very concerned about our business model, and and we appreciate the concern. what we ended up doing is, because there was so much concern about it, and a lot of it was from the community, is we said, if you're so concerned about it, work with us to come up with a model that you'll be able to support. And so we've actually got volunteers helping us come up with a business model that's going to work with different communities. And so I think, like, those are the kinds of conversations that and involvement that people want in news. And the fact that we've been able to fund, you know, as many stories that we have, and we have this other story, too, that we're actually funding beats now. One of the beats that we're funding is the City Hall beat in San Francisco. And that was a $5,000 beat, and that was requested by the community, saying, you know, we're really interested in seeing what's going on in San Francisco. Why, like, where's our money going? Why is our budget so bad? We need more reporters in there. And we've already been able to fundraise $2,000 of that just from, like, you know, going out there, giving flyers, people just donating $10, $5, a dollar, which actually costs us money, you know, and it's getting there. And I think that that's the kind of thing, those experiments we need to encourage. You know, like, just even sitting with Cynthia in the back, I was like, oh, you know what, we should do more work together. That sounds really great, you know?
Right, and to follow on to that, actually, we're not a news site. We're a service for news and other content sites to make money from readers like you, who actually want to support and have more, have better quality news or whatever it is you like, whether it's, you know, entertainment or other kinds of content. We've done some revenue calculations for some of the large newspapers because we're talking to most of them, along with some of the magazine publishers, et cetera. And some of these big newspapers can make, from our system, we believe can make tens of millions, even hundreds of millions of dollars a year if they really turn out high quality content and they can convince their users that this is something that should be supported and something they want to be part of their persona. So in a way, Spot Us and Kachingle were kind of these two ends of the bookend where they're funding the generation of new content, and what we do is help existing content be funded. So many of you said, in fact, most of you said you read the newspaper, and I think you were talking about the paper newspaper, but how many of you read news online? And I mean any kind of news online. So
most,
you know, you
again, almost everybody.
Yeah, okay, so, you know, how many of you are supporting that monetarily online?
Okay, three hands.
Most
hands out of 150.
Most of you are freeloaders, right? Yeah, I can put a big thing in your
Luchers.
Head. You're freeloaders. We're going to give you a system by which you can say, no, you're not, that you support the SF Gate, that it's something that's important to you, that you support Phil Bronstein's blog, even. You
but
can
why
get down
should
to that
they?
Level.
Not to pick on Phil, but why should they? If they can
you
get it for free, why should they?
Pardon me?
If they can get it for free now, why should they?
Because you can make it part of your persona, that these are the things you really care about. For instance, on the New York Times, which I do read along with the Chronicle, there's certain blogs that I really love, and I would like to support them. I'd like them to be part of my persona. It's part of being part of a community and part of being part of society.
Do you something wants to say? Yeah. Not about his blog necessarily.
You know, I think one of the great temptations, one of the evil temptations for journalists is to see things in black and white. I think we always have to watch out for that. And I think that there is a black and white component to the ongoing discussion about the future of news and the future of journalism that disturbs me. First of all, I think there's a certain snobbery that exists in part of that discussion. I think that one of the things that's hurt journalism and newsrooms and newspapers, in addition to the larger issue of the business model, is this sort of higher calling disease. Well, we have a higher calling disease. We have a higher calling. We have a social purpose, which both of which are true. But as a result, we're really not going to pay much attention to people because we're journalists and we know better and we're going to make all the decisions. So I tell the slightly apocryphal story of a journalist who gets a phone call from a reader and he says, I can't take the call. I'm too busy committing journalism. And I think that there, Lowell's comment about stenography, I think, doesn't do justice to a lot of newspapers, many of which in this country were responsible for creating the sense of community that Kara talked about initially. And I think they performed, that was a very important role for them to perform, whether or not they were breaking big national stories or whether they should have been breaking big national stories. I do think that there are two paths here. One is the one we're talking about mostly, which is, or will be talking about, because of the people on the panel, which is how do you fund the traditional notion of journalism? That is to say, people who are trained to go out and collect information, hold people accountable, perform a watchdog function. We need a watchdog. That's what this says right here. So I think it's important that we determine how we fund that. And I'm on the board of the Center for Investigative Reporting in Berkeley, which Lowell co-founded and is a very important piece of that experiment. But at the same time, we have the public. Now, I think the notions of citizen journalism, Lowell's history notwithstanding, have just not worked so far. They just haven't worked. And I can go on forever why they haven't worked, but that's really, I think, not significant in the discussion. What's significant in the discussion is that you cannot ignore, and nor should you ignore, the ubiquity of the public, the access to information that the public has that professional journalists often don't have. You know, they used to be called sources. Now they're called citizen journalists. And now we have an extraordinary array of ways to tap into that information. We saw this in Iran. Verifying information is tough, but that's what professional journalists can do. The question is, as you go down this one route, which is how do you pay for professional journalism, or how do you support, I should say, professional journalism, I think you have to go down this parallel path, which is what is the interaction, what is the interplay, what is the relationship with the public that now has the ability to show you things and tell you things instantly that didn't exist 10 or 15 or 20 or 100 years ago. So brief example? We have an outdoors writer named Tom Steenstra. And Tom is very well known around here and elsewhere as an outdoors writer. And he did a blog post a couple of years ago when the guy fell off Half Dome and died. And the blog post had, 500, 600 comments on it. And if you went through the comments, what you found within the comments was that there were people there who now had the accessibility to comment on his blog who were present, who were eyewitnesses to this guy falling off Half Dome. Some of them were above him, some of them were below him. And so if you went through this, now, you know, it's the job, I think, of professionals to try to vet the information. But there it is. There's the raw material to vastly expand the story. We had another instance on this blog that someone mentioned. There's a guy who writes his own blog, and he's a student at San Francisco State, and his thing is griping about Muni, about the public transportation, because that's what a lot of bloggers do. They gripe. And so we happened to see one where he said, hey, they're supposed to give a 25-cent discount when you leave the ballpark and get on Muni to go on BART. And they're not giving me one. Well, I decided, because I still have the name of an institution that has some remnant of support left to it and reputation, that I called Muni on behalf of this guy, having seen his blog, and said, why is this guy not getting his 25 cents? And because I was calling from the Chronicle, as opposed to I'm Fred Smith and I have a blog, Muni went, oh my God, we're gonna fix this. Don't worry about it. We're gonna get out there and we're gonna tell our vendors they have to do it. The next time this guy, and he said, the next time this gentleman goes to a homestand game of the Giants, San Francisco Giants, he will get his 25-cent discount. So the guy went with his camera to the next homestand game, and he went up to the Muni vendor, and guess what? Didn't get his 25-cent discount. So we posted that. He posted it on his blog. We went back to Muni. Muni, at that point, was ready to blow its brains out and said, okay, now we're really going to take this seriously. And sure enough, as far as we can tell, everyone now gets a 25-cent discount. Now, it's only 25 cents, but that's a watchdog role where professionals and amateurs work together to make a story happen and to do what journalists, we always say we want to do, which is change things for the better. So I think you need those two parallel paths, and you cannot denigrate either one.
Go ahead, Cynthia.
Well, I just wanted to make a comment that, and it relates to what Phil is talking about, which is, you know, the news really used to be, like you say, from professional journalists, and that was kind of defined it. But everything is user-centric now. I mean, for each one of you, the news is what you think is news, whether it's some blog that you're reading, the Huffington Post, the New York Times, a particular columnist, a video on YouTube. I mean, whatever you think of value, it's all around you, the individual. And I think that is just a totally different mindset and shift than what it's been before. And along with that, and yes, there's citizen journalists, but it's, you know, something like 40% of people below 30 have blogs. And of course, now everybody's tweeting. I mean, everyone is now becoming part of this conversation, and everyone's getting value from lots of sources. And I think people are going to want to contribute to those sources, to give back to them, to make them part of who I am. It's just a totally different situation than it used to be, where everything was being broadcast to us.
Well, to dissent, basically, I don't believe that the news is a church newsletter. I don't believe that what we're talking about, I'm not saying that people don't and can't have local newspapers mimeographed or in the old days or distributed or even online. I think that that's not the economic problem that faces the news business today in the United States. As Phil laid it out at the beginning, 70% of the cost of producing a newspaper goes to its production process. Only 30% or less goes to the editorial function. And the editorial function, I think, that it's in danger is not having local conversations. Obviously, you can do more of that with the internet. You have free access, you can blog, you can talk to people. The problem is, how do you fund somebody who's a trained journalist sitting in City Hall who actually recognizes people? What do we say when I've had some federal judges to my seminar at Berkeley who are complaining that the reporters, when they do show up, are only there for the opening arguments and the closing arguments and are no longer sitting through the whole case? What do you do with a police department that never really got, in my opinion, real coverage and has never really been transformed or reformed when it has even fewer people covering it? What do you do in a metropolitan area whose news media nationally was known for not really living up to the possible potential of the San Francisco Bay Area? For example, we know very little about the major privately held corporations that are headquartered here, because the business sections and the sports sections of newspapers are more or less the same. They were the largest sections of the paper, and they were mostly doing what I would call a positive approach, let's say, to sports and to business, but never had, for instance, got rid of all their labor reporters. So I just know from my experience working as a reporter and a producer, both in television and print, that it's we as reporters in general have been dissatisfied with the amount of resources that went into real reporting. The current decline is dangerous because we're not getting the kind of national, regional, and local coverage that really digs all the time. That's the difference between, I think, where I started out, let's say, as my own version of a late 60s citizen journalist, where I didn't have any resources, didn't have any expense money. I had to hitchhike to get to a story. And that and someone who's actually got some training, some resources behind them, and so on. And that's the danger period we're in now. I think there will be a turnaround there, because there is a demand for that kind of journalism, that kind of news reporting. And I do believe that both nonprofit and public financing is going to get involved in both.
Well, can I just ask you a quick question, Lowell? So do you believe, though, that if people had an easy way, a frictionless way, to fund this kind of journalism as opposed to all the other stuff, that they would be willing to do it?
Well, yeah, they could. They could do it if they, for example, it became a public program. You know, if we fund political campaigns, you can check it off on your income tax. Why can't we fund, create a, we have a corporation for public broadcasting. We have tax benefits for the wealthy to create foundations, which in turn fund journalism, and particularly the kind of journalism that now is in danger. So there's a lot of ways of doing it beyond micropayments. If Google, for instance, in discussions I've had with them, we did a four-hour series on Frontline about the state of the news business. In fact, interviewed Phil as part of it. And in the interviews with Eric Schmidt and with Yahoo News, we asked, why don't you guys buy the New York Times, since you're repurposing it every day? They don't do any news gathering. They repurpose the news and basically get advertising directly and indirectly through that. Why isn't Google paying a micropayment for every search of the news that's done by people who click on Google? And that goes into some fund to back journalism, or what we would call journalism that pursues stories without fear or favor. So there are a lot of other alternatives, it seems to me, but it requires a public discussion, similar to the public discussion that's now going on about how do you create a banking industry that's responsible and not irresponsible and isn't putting itself out of business. In many ways, the newspaper business was the canary in the mine in terms of where the economy of the United States was going. And that business is collapsing because the economic model is collapsing. I'd also point out, by the way, that these news organizations made tons of money for decades with public, either with public licensing in terms of broadcasting or antitrust exemptions given to it by the government, and have never really paid back for those privileges, the people who own the organizations.
I'm not sure what Lowell was dissenting about, but I'd like to just add, not a dissent, but a cautionary notion about public financing or nonprofit. In public financing, Lowell cited some good examples of countries where public financing of journalism has worked well. I would be a little nervous myself about government financing when people started talking about bailouts of newspapers. Why don't you bail out newspapers? My first response, and maybe it was the wrong response, was, are you kidding? The government is the most powerful institution we cover. And I really don't particularly want them even thinking that they can tell us what to do in terms of how we cover them. In terms of privately funded, again, I think you know, the Center for Investigative Reporting has recently gotten some funding for some projects, including something called the California Project, which is precisely to replace the reporting that was being done by news organizations, newspaper organizations that had big bureaus in Sacramento and no longer do, because that's government, and then government needs watching always. But you know, then you have ProPublica, which was really the first or most high-profile privately funded investigative group. And ProPublica had a problem. And the problem ProPublica had is that it was funded solely by a family that ended up, rightly or wrongly, involved in the financial collapse. They owned Golden West.
Let me interrupt you right there. The Hearst Corporation, which you work for, has not only had the advantage of tax laws that give it various privileges, is privately held, we don't know what they own, has a reputation over the years for not reporting on a number of subjects, including itself and what it owns in the area, as well as other privately held companies in the Bay Area. So because you have a certain financial backer, whether it's private or public, I don't think defines how good the reporting or the journalism is.
Well,
I think
I'm not
it has
sure
to
that
do
it
with
defines it, Lowell. I'm saying you're making my point, which is that whether it's funded by a large company, and you know, since if you're going to talk about Hearst, you should have disclosure that you've had some issues with Hearst in the past. That
you want to get into that?
Whether it's not, maybe
I'm
that was
happy
that
to
was before
I'm happy
time.
To
all get along.
I'm talking
maybe
about
our next
panel.
But I'm just what I'm saying is you're pointing out that there are issues with large companies, private and public.
Exactly.
And I'm saying that there are also issues with some of these, quote, new models that we're talking about.
By the way, I will say.
Wait, hold on. Let me say something.
So Cynthia in the middle. Go ahead.
And then I want her to be able to talk, too, which is, so what we're proposing is that you fund the news. We don't need, you know.
And we have a big hat in the back in case you want to drop some money.
I mean, seriously, that individuals, that you, that all of you decide what kind of news you think is important, and you have, and what we're giving you is easy mechanisms to fund the news yourself. So you don't have to worry about Hearst and what they're doing. You don't have to worry about the government. You know, it can be, you know, back to the people, crowdfunding, crowdsourcing. And that's what we think the new wave of journalism will be funded by.
I think what's also really important is that, you know, I just read something that a colleague of ours, Josh Wilson, runs Newsdesk, gave me, and it's called The Smart Nonprofit. And one of the things that I found really interesting in that document was that it was talking about how nonprofits become most effective when they're collaborating with one another, and they stop seeing themselves as a spoke of a wheel and more as a node within a social network of, you know, people who are driven by certain missions or missions that are similar. And I think, like, that's what we're finding at Spot Us is proving to be very efficient and productive, both for our audiences and for the content that we produce, is that we collaborate a lot with different folks, and we're always looking for collaborations. And we're not focused on growing our business model or growing our organization. We're just focused on our mission and making that mission happen as much as possible to fund investigative reporting with people who are already doing this kind of thing, whether it's public media, whether it's Kachingle, whether it's working, you know, going over the Guardian and saying, hey, are you interested in, you know, funding this beat on recycle, you know, following your recyclables? I mean, all these different things I think are necessary to have collaboration on, and I think we should all get along, and I think we should all work together personally.
Carl, let me ask you though, if it's true of Kachingle too, but of Spot Us, if what stories get covered depend on what money people give and,
sure.
and to which or where they direct it, what about the people who can't afford to give any money? Won't that direct coverage towards things that people with money are most interested in? How does it democratize? When I'm covering a story, I don't
sure.
think about who's funding it or paying my paycheck. I go out and do the story that we feel needs to be covered. How do you get around that?
You mean like stories that don't get any funding at all?
Exactly.
We find that like there's different kinds of stories that get funded in different different speeds. Like for example, like we had a story on crime in Oakland, and that was funded within 48 hours. People were really interested in looking at the police investigation, like looking at like investigation in the police department in Oakland. And this was before the Oscar Grant thing happened. And essentially, we had a couple bloggers blog about it. And it, within 48 hours, we had gotten our $1,000 of funding for that. And then we've had other stories that stay on the shelf a little bit longer. A longest story was our longevity revolution story that we did. And that took about like a month to fund, like a month and a half. And I think what we find is that, you know, a lot of times, you know, it's kind of like one of my favorite movies is Soylent Green. I don't know, imagine. Tell them journalism is made of people. And it's true. You know, I think that, like, if a story isn't resonating with someone, it's either like, you know, we either haven't gone out there and done our organizing to reach an audience, or we just haven't, like, you know, in some ways made that story relevant to that audience. So, like, when we find that a story is sitting on our shelf for a little bit, we're like, you know, we need to think about this and ask people in the community what they want the story to be and help them, you know, be part of the shaping of it. And so, like, I often go out there and I flyer. Like, you know, if you see me at Safeway with flyers, please don't pass me by. Take my flyer. I do all kinds of community, activism and organizing. And my background is in public health and journalism. You know, and the day you told me that I was going to be doing journalism was going to be an active community organizing, I would have been like, what? But it's true. I think community, journalism has become community organizing to a certain extent. Not all journalism, because I think some investigative journalism, just requires so much research and work. But I think a lot of community journalism, public media does require that.
For those in our audience here, we're going to be taking your questions soon. So if you have a question you would like to ask the panel, there are microphones in each aisle. Come on up. Start lining up at the mic now. And we'll get to you in just a few minutes.
Full disclosure, I've had major public disagreements with the Hearst Corporation and with CBS. And so that said, I would say that what we all really valued was the fact that there was not supposed to be a connection between the business side of the organization and the news side of the organization. And that has broken down in most of the major news organizations in the United States, unfortunately.
Is there something that Kara sure. mentioned? I covered the Philippines for quite a few years during the whole Marcos Aquino business. And, you know, I got to know a lot of people, and I got to know a lot of things, and I thought I understood the country pretty well. But when anyone would ask me how they should learn about what was going on in the Philippines, I would always tell them to read multiple sources. Because in the years that I spent overseas as a foreign correspondent, I met some of the most brilliant colleagues, reporters, that are working or were working in our field. And I'm sure Lowell would agree on my choice of most of them. I also met some of the worst. And some of those people were working for some of the largest media outlets in the world. So I think nothing is flawless. And I think that when Kara talks about the sense of patchwork, that's what I'm talking about, that sort of that second parallel route, that you're going to be helped ultimately by people being everywhere all the time. If you can figure out how to tap into that, it's going to help you tell a truer story. You know, Clarence Barron, the co-founder of the Wall Street Journal, said, facts aren't the truth, they just indicate where the truth may lie. And we need to get more facts. We always need to get more facts to get closer to the truth. And I just see these social media opportunities as opportunities, not necessarily separate from the serious work that we all must do to hold the government accountable or to open the door on spying of citizens or unjust wars, but in every sense of what we do. I think it's really an important thing. So I'm particularly glad we're talking both with Cynthia and with Kara, not Kara specifically, but Spot Us, about partnerships, because I do think that those are important.
I just wanted to mention that we are in discussions with the Center for Public Integrity and the Center for Investigative Research, and they're planning to use Kachingle as a source of fundraising. And I think it's really paternalistic to think that people can't vote with their money on the kinds of stories that they want to support. You know, we're not children. We should be able, if we want to hear more about City Hall, we should be able to have an easy way to support that, those kinds of stories. If we want to hear more about Paris Hilton, we should have an easy way to support that. You know, we are who we are, and I think that it's a very fair way of kind of, you know, voting with your money on what kind of news and what kind of content that you want to have. And there's really, you know, it's a new medium, and it's just going to be totally different. And I think people will be surprised and happy with the kind of results that come out of it.
Should the news media have a role, though, in deciding what people need, what we think they should want, as opposed to just saying, oh, they're all going to want Britney Spears? Should someone play that role, or should it just be up to the public?
Well, you know, I look to the Min Post as kind of the vanguard, and we're also in discussions with them. And they're a news organization all online. I think it's about 40 reporters. Started by Joel Kramer, you know, very prestigious group of journalists. They're being very successful. You know, they know what kind of news people of Minnesota want, and I think people are supporting that. So I think journalists, you know, have all the right ideas, and the, you know, they have the context. They know how to. I mean, I've been very impressed by the journalists that have covered my company. I mean, they got it right, and they worked really hard, and I was just totally impressed. And I come from high tech, so I didn't know anything about journalism. But I think this whole thing of interacting with people and the citizen journalists, it's all just going to be a big mix that people will be able to support with money.
As a reminder to our radio audience, this program is presented by the Commonwealth Club's INFORUM. Tonight our topic is Newspapers Are Dead, Now What? I'm Doug Sovern of KCBS, your moderator. Joining us here in the discussion, we have Phil Bronstein of the San Francisco Chronicle and Hearst Newspapers, Kara Andrade of Spot Us, Cynthia Typaldos, founder and president of Kachingle, and Lowell Bergman, professor at the UC Berkeley School of Journalism and producer, director of documentaries for PBS. Let's go to the audience for at least a couple of questions here. Ma'am, your question for the panel?
I have two, if I may. One for Cynthia, talking about when you said every one of us decides what's news, I was appalled because I see a world of 90% Michael Jackson death coverage and maybe 10% what's going on in Iran coverage. The public is too varied to say they're smart or they're stupid, but the public is not going to decide in massive numbers to have stories about what's going on with the elections in Iran.
What's your question, ma'am?
How can you possibly leave it in the hands of the public? And for Lowell, working in public broadcasting, you've seen what's happened with government funding when the government in power doesn't like some of the things that have been done, NEA and so forth like that. So while I wish that could be a solution, do you really think that the government, as Phil was saying, do you want the government deciding what's going to be covered?
So your question was directed to me first and then
yes.
Cynthia first.
So I have an easy answer for that. Yes, I think people want great news and great journalism. I think it's very hard now to direct your money toward those things. And it's like, you know, who would have believed that, you know, half of the world's population wanted to have a blog? Well, it was just too hard to do. And ease of use is everything. And I think you'll be happily surprised that when there are mechanisms, such as my company and Spot Us and others, to allow people to fund the things that they really want to know about, that great, they'll be funding great content and great news and not just the things that you see now that are easier to do.
And Lowell?
I hope.
Well, first of all, I think that we don't really take a really hard look at what's actually going on in the country. 27% of the people in the United States are illiterate. Basically illiterate. And so even to think about what the background is and so on, not that they can't make choices if they're illiterate, it's just we have to talk about the realities of both the presentation of information and choices people can make. Now, in the public broadcasting system, the reality is if you go back 40 years, there was a commitment to actually start a new network, a public television network with full news. With the networks were very scared because of Newton Minow, who had been head of the FCC, had called it a vast wasteland. They were worried about more regulation. So they were putting more money and resources and giving up themselves to start what became public television. As soon as the Nixon administration came in and it changed, they created this balkanized system with the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and all these stations around the country and no real unified news operation except for what became the Lehrer NewsHour, which is now the Lehrer NewsHour, which, by the way, is a profit-making company, and a very disparate system. There's currently some effort within public broadcasting, mostly led by David Fanning at Frontline, to try and develop a new news, revitalized news operation inside public television. Most of public television gets its money from private donations at this point. And the government money is relatively minimal. Government funding of public television and public broadcasting has been flat for the last 12 years. So that's the first part of it, just the realities of it. Now, if you want to go into the future, there can be certain controls put in place. Look at the BBC. They get money from every television and radio that's sold in the United Kingdom. That's how they get their money, and there's a board that distributes it. If you look at the nonprofit models, which are now growing, particularly in areas like investigative reporting, again, that's coming out of a government dispensation for people to write off the money. And wherever the money comes from, as far as I'm concerned, as long as there's no strings attached, we can use it to do reporting. So I think you have to have insulation in that area, and you also have to have oversight in the private area, because private press, going back 100 years to the Hearst Corporation, was not exactly that responsible in the way it produced news for the American public. So both sides can be screwed up in terms of the way they do things and not serve the public interest by doing what they should be doing. But this is an opportunity, I think, right now to rethink these models, and using could be some of these models that we're talking about here, and I definitely think Spot On as a way of people on the street participating and getting involved more in what stories they want, it's great. But we do have to think about trying to preserve the legacy of, I think, what has been created over the last two centuries.
Let's go to this gentleman with a question here for the panel.
Whether it's done badly or done well, almost all the news gathering in this country has been done by the staffs of newspapers.
I would take issue with that as a radio journalist. But
oh, the radio journalist.
Yeah, yes, but we do want questions rather than statements, folks,
fact,
by the way.
A very interesting fact. There are 11 reporters right at your
at
station,
KCBS,
and that's
11.
The most for any commercial.
We have the most of
KCBS
any commercial
is
organization
money,
in America.
Folks.
Yeah. For let's, any commercial station in the
let's
country.
Let's say that most
okay.
of the news
Oh, that's fair enough.
We need to continue to have trained journalists in this country, and I'd like from Professor Bergman and Mr. Bronstein perhaps a little fuller explanation of where the money's going to come from for these journalists who are going to be making, what, $40,000, $80,000 a year if they're good?
My graduate seminar, we did a study about 7 years ago before all this happened. If you went to graduate school in journalism, and after 5 years outside, once you got through the graduate school of journalism, you would make the same amount of money of someone who graduated at 18 from high school and went into the postal service for 5 years. The difference is the postal worker would have benefits and you wouldn't. So this has never been a business where you go into it to make money.
I can definitely support that.
That is right. True.
The question was not the level of support, right, but just that there be support. Is that right?
The question basically was, we need to have professional, trained journalists that make at least a living wage.
Right.
Where's the money going to come from in the future to support that cadre of hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of journalists in the future?
Well, I think the experimentation, there is no set answer to that, to your question. I'm sorry to say, I wish there were. But what's going on, the kind of experimentation, whether it's Spot Us or Warren Hellman is coming up with apparently some new idea that is sort of like public television, but not. I think a lot of people are experimenting, and panic can be a great motivator, and not to mention losing all your money. And I think that people have been highly motivated, including journalists who are facing, 20,000 journalists have lost their jobs. I mean, everyone is motivated. And so I think that that's why I'm encouraged. It may be that people view some of these experiments as not high-minded enough, but I think we ought to look at every possibility for funding, except for people who, as in the old days, maybe wanted to buy a story about themselves. Short of that, I think we ought to be looking at all possible means of funding the kind of journalism you're talking about, because, yes, it is essential.
Ma'am, you have a question?
Well, speaking of buying a story about yourself, newspapers are dead. What's going to happen to local news like obituaries? Local events. What happens to the local event kinds of news like obituaries when we have no more newspapers?
Well, perhaps Cynthia or Cara wants to take that one on. Local news coverage.
You pay for your obituary.
If it's an online website. I might start obituary.com now that I just had an idea. I don't know.
I think there's a niche right
probably
there. Tweet that one.
You know, I don't really, maybe I'm missing something here, but I don't see a difference between, you know, it's all about the content that you want. If you want local news, then that's what you'll support. And there's a lot of new local news sites springing up. I mean, even here in San Francisco. It can be part of a larger news organization. I mean, I think people are going to be able to, with these new mechanisms, be able to focus in on the news and other information that they want and support that. So I don't see it being, you know, kind of separate out from, you know, I love international news. I'm really interested in Afghanistan, but I'm also really interested in, you know, what's going on, you know, in Silicon Valley. It's me. It's all about me. I'm the user, and I've got this wide range of interests, and that's what I think is so great about the internet, is that, you know, you don't just get what's delivered to you in this package that used to be the newspaper or magazine. You know, you surf, you choose this and that and whatever, and you pick out the things that are uniquely of interest to you. So I see, you know, people are very interested in local news, and it'll be supported in the same way that other kinds of news are.
There are local news sites that are springing up, Public Press, SF Appeal, and a lot of them have professional journalists. Now, to the last gentleman's question, I'm not sure they're getting paid at the moment, but it's not as though these local news sites are staffed by amateurs.
Right. There's the Voice of San Diego. If you haven't looked at it, you might want to check that out.
And the
but
internet,
it's, again, it's a business model that is not making money, but it is taking investors.
Not yet.
And the internet can be hyper-local, down to the blog about a particular street. Again, we're not sure always who's writing it, but it can be hyper-local, as Cara would probably tell you.
Well, one of the things that we found out really quickly is that everybody has a blog within, really close to each other. Like when I, in Oakland, for example, the crime spot blogging, you know, blog actually will look at crime, will actually send you an email of, you know, crime that's happened within, like, even like a mile radius of your zip code. So, like, if you think about things like that and, like, you know, mapping, you know, different sites like that and being able to overlay news on that, I think there's a lot of room for experimentation. I keep saying that because I think it's really important that we play. You know, I think we've lost that sense of playfulness and that spirit of ingenuity which has so often defined the U.S. And I think we need to go back to that. I feel that we've stopped with journalism. We've stopped, like, you know, really thinking about what's going to work for us as a community. And each community is so different. Like, what works for Oakland is not going to work for San Francisco. I can pretty much guarantee that's going to be so different based on, like, the demographics, the age group, the interest level. And I think it has to be community driven. And people will stand behind the like what they want to see, and they will put their money towards it. It may not be a lot, but they will, after a while, even $1, $2, like, it does add up to real money.
Before you bang the gavel, I just want to say there was a brief bit of fur flying here, but I have to say for the record that very, very few journalists in this country have held powerful individuals and organizations accountable the way Lowell Bergman has, and Al Pacino did not do him justice.
And just on, not to be morbid, but on obituaries, the death announcements in the newspapers are paid, and they're one of the few profit centers the papers have left.
Yeah, New York.
So they're not going anywhere.
The New York Times makes a lot of money off those lists.
They've lost the classifieds. They still have the death announcements, so they're not going anywhere, whether it's on paper or online. Sir, you have a question?
Thank you. As a sort of follow-up to the financing question, where is this money going to come from, I'm particularly curious about online newspaper sites, SFGate, NYTimes.com, what have you. It seems to me that even up to a few years ago, at least some section of those sites was a pay-for area, be it in the archives or what have you. And I'm particularly curious if there is, well, first, why that changed as to being almost completely free now, it seems to me. Instead of paying $2 to the New York Times, I can just go online and receive almost the entire edition for free. One, I'm curious why there was that change in the industry. And second, I'm curious if there's any sort of desire to change back, basically saying, look, we need this money. And I'm curious if there's an effort inside the industry to make that once again paid-for news online.
I think fear is what changed it first. I think what happened is the New York Times started Time Select, the Los Angeles Times started something similar where they charged for certain kinds of material, of content, and the numbers dropped precipitously. And so everyone got panicked and stopped charging. Now, Rupert Murdoch is the last, well, he's not the last person, but he's one of the last people who's still charging. Now, I think what you've heard a little bit of tonight is now there's a stampede. How do we charge? You know, there was a Appalachian-like meeting of, you know, the heads of the newspaper companies outside of Chicago not too long ago, where really that was the topic of discussion. And Steve Brill from American Lawyer is one of the people who's got a company that, you know, as does Cynthia, and a number of other people who are saying, hey, look, we'll help you charge, whether it's micropayments or whether it's some subscription system or some other system. But I think there is now a big push. How do we charge? Part of it is, you know, you're trying to put the toothpaste back in the tube because you've offered this stuff for free for so long. But, you know, then we have new devices. Can we charge for the devices? Can we charge for the Kindle? Can we charge for, you know, you getting your news content on handheld devices? Is that a way, sort of, okay, we missed the boat on the laptop, but how about the devices?
I just want to say I'm quite familiar with the Time Select and what's been going on in the space, and these paywalls are really the kiss of death. I mean, no one's going to tweet an article behind a paywall. I mean, to me, the Wall Street Journal is now irrelevant because I can never figure out when you can drill in or not. And there are, you know, it's, we're talking to a lot of these companies. They are looking at things like paywalls. We think that's, you know, a mistake, but we think there are mechanisms like Kachingle that allow people to pay, you know, without any effort and support journalism and still make it something that you can share. I mean, social sharing is everything. Now, this is how, you know, you really find out what's going on in many cases. So you've got to really enable that. You cannot cut that off. What I heard, in fact, for Time Select is that they put all of their top columnists behind that paywall, and they started to become like nobodies. And it sounds like Lowell has a problem.
Well, I just want to just say that there is a pay-for-information, high-quality information industry out there. It's online, and it's in print. It's basically newsletters. on specialized subjects. They charge $1,000 a year or more. And every if you have money, you can get quality information. And many journalists, some of whom graduated from Berkeley recently in the Graduate School of Journalism, have gotten jobs in these newsletters. But you've got to have a lot of money to pay for that kind of information. The information's out there. It's being generated. Energy newsletters, you name it, that people pay for that kind of information, banking and so on, asset forfeiture, money laundering. You can go down the whole list, and they have an association, and they meet in Washington, and as I understand it from people in it who own some of these, they're making money hand over fist. Again, what we're coming back to is having quality information that you may not have been aware of or would have chosen to select yourself, available to a mass audience, so that mass audience can then have a common understanding of what's going on in society. That's what's been created over the last 40-some-odd years. It wasn't always that way. And that's what we're in danger of losing, and that's this transition period that we're in.
I think we have time for one last quick question and maybe one quick answer. Sir, what is your question?
Okay, so when I first found out about Michael Jackson's death, I admit it was through Twitter and Facebook, and it wasn't through a news website. But amidst all the news about that was also a lot of misinformation, like rumors that Jeff Goldblum had also died. And so I was wondering what you thought about people going to places like Facebook and Twitter for news where they have the benefit of live updating, but also they have less journalistic integrity and less fact-checking, things like that.
I would love to speak to that, mostly because I really love Michael Jackson. One of the things that I've noticed, especially in the past couple of days when we launched this, independent of Spadas, but we launched this citizen journalism portal, which is called Habla Honduras, is that a lot of people have been tweeting about what's going on in Honduras because a lot of the main media has been blocked out of Honduras, and there's like nobody has internet. There's just like a lot going on. There's been like a lot of, a lot of these updates have been coming through, but journalists have been asking me, they go, well, where are you getting these updates from? Are they accurate? Have we had someone do an accuracy check on these? How do we know that these things are actually happening? And I can't go through and actually check them, so I feel like one of the things that I did when I was going through a lot of these different mobile dispatches that were sent is like I asked people, could you help me to kind of fact check this thing, because I can't do it as one person. I need the crowd. I mean, that's where the wisdom of the crowd comes in. I think that like anything, I mean, as reporters, we're taught that you can't trust one source. Like when you write a story, you're not gonna write a story just from interviewing one or two people. You're gonna write a story, most of the time you end up interviewing like 10 people, and you might take like, maybe three people's different quotes. And I think that's what we forget, that even though social media is there, we still have to apply the journalistic craft everything that we do, and the integrity and the practices that we've learned as journalists, and those are things like fact-checking and getting as many sources as possible. And I think there's a whole another level too now with like computational journalism, as my friend Eric Sundeloff is All Voices, and there's ways to also implement accuracy checks that are automated. Can you believe that? Could actually get computers to actually work with the journalists and make their work more possible.
There's so much more we could say and ask about this issue, but I'm afraid we've run out of time. And audience, I'd just like you to give a big hand to our panel tonight for their thoughts. Thanks very much. Thank you. I'm Doug Sovern, and this meeting of Inforum and the Commonwealth Club is adjourned.